Hello learners, welcome to our environmental science course at senior secondary level. In the previous program, we discussed lesson number 1 titled Origin of Earth and Evolution of Environment. I am Neelam Gupta, course coordinator of this course. Welcome you in this program. It is well established fact that there is a relationship between the environment and the human society. The environment has played a great role in shaping the human societies, but we human beings too have affected the environment. Interactions between the human society and the environment are constantly changing. Primitive humans lived in forests, near water bodies, and interacted with the environment as hunters and gatherers. I would like to add that the human beings, scientific name Homo sapiens sapiens, evolved more than 2 million years ago. They evolved with a large brain that enabled them to think and use their judgment. Humans walked erect on 2 legs, which made their hands free to negotiate manual functions. Dear learners, since environment is important in shaping human societies, let me discuss in detail about environment and society, which is lesson number 2 of environmental science course. Objective of this course are to understand the natural resources obtained from the environment, trace the evolution of Homo sapiens sapiens, discuss about the primitive humans as hunters and gatherers, describe the tools used by primitive humans, and explain how the nomadic humans started living a settled life. Let me begin with the primitive humans. Do you think environment played any role in shaping the life of primitive humans? Well, yes, it did. Primitive humans interacted with environment for survival. As humans became more and more cultured, they devised means of using environmental resources for making life comfortable and protecting themselves from various environmental stresses, that is dangers. What are these environmental resources? These natural resources can be biotic or abiotic. Dear learners, just look around and count for yourself the items of use around you. You list the rivers, trees, flowers, sunlight, houses, books, table, chair, etc. The list is long, isn't it? Our environment has resources which can be classified into 2 categories, the non-living or abiotic and the living or biotic. Abiotic resources are from the physical part of nature, as you might see in mountains, plains, rivers, seas in physical maps, energy, natural gas and petroleum, metals or minerals. Biotic resources are from the biological part of nature, includes plants, animals, and microorganisms. You can see in the image that natural abiotic resources are land, water, energy, natural gas, petroleum and petroleum products, metal ores. Let us understand the role of each of these abiotic natural resources in shaping the human society. Let me begin with land as a natural resource. You must have studied a physical map. What all is included in a physical map? Mountains, rocks, deserts, plains, grasslands, forests and swamps. We humans not only make our homes in these land areas, but also prepare fields for cultivation and grow crops according to the prevailing climate. Sheds for cattle and other shelters are also constructed and roads carved out for travel and transportation. Land is also utilized for flyovers, subways and of course for erecting factories. Industrialization and urbanization are also human projects which diminish natural land resources. What do we infer from this? That our needs are much more than the available land resources. Now let us talk about water as a natural resource. Water is another important natural resource. We all know that life cannot exist without water. Our country has plenty of rivers and is surrounded by sea from 3 sides, but we still face the scarcity of potable water. This is because what we extensively use is fresh water from natural water bodies, which is filtered and sent through pipes and taps to our urban homes. We only catch fish from sea water and travel on ships on it, but cannot use it for our everyday activities. The natural water bodies include oceans, seas and surface water bodies such as rivers, lakes, waterfalls and ponds. Almost 80% of the Earth's fresh water remains frozen at higher latitude and on mountain tops. Only 20% is available in liquid form. Do you know what is the primary source of water for us? Answer is, the primary source of water on land is the rainfall. The 20% of the available fresh water on land is used for various purposes. Let us list the various uses of water. Water is required for irrigation of agricultural crops, industries, building construction, culture of fish, prawn, aquatic plants, that is aquaculture, drinking, bathing, cleaning, washing, gardening, pottery, making, etc. Water, though, is a naturally replenishable resource, but overuse and wastage of water is leading to its scarcity. Now, let me discuss with you the next important natural resource, important in shaping the human society, that is energy. We all know that the primitive source of energy is solar radiation. Primitive humans used firewood and cow dung and other animal waste for heating and cooking. Oil extracted from seeds and fish was used by them to light caves and shelters. Another major source of energy is fossil fuel such as coal. Coal, as you know, has been formed from vegetation which grew millions of years ago, fell and got trapped in sediments. Under immense pressure and intense heat for years, trees and vegetation buried in sediments got transformed into coal. Dear learners, we all know coal is a very important natural resource. How is it important to us? Now we come to the uses of coal. Coal is used as a fuel for cooking, for running locomotives, furnaces, important in industries, for generating electricity. Coal is also used for extraction of metals and minerals and in thermal power generation. Today, petroleum natural gas are lifeline for humans. Petroleum and natural gas are fossil fuels buried under earth. Do you know how many years it took for these to form and what formed them? Petroleum probably originated from marine animals that lived during past geological periods, just as coal was formed from vegetation. Millions of years ago, animals and plants lived during that period got buried under their death under layers and layers of soil, and the pressure converted them into fossil fuels. This did not happen in a year or two. It took thousands of years for their formation. Since it took years to form, these are considered as non-renewable energy sources. Our human society is so much dependent on petroleum and its products. So let us list the uses of petroleum products. They are used for running automobiles, steamers and aeroplanes. I hope you know that petrol and diesel are refined petroleum products. Petroleum also used for making plastics and fertilizers. You might have heard about CNG, that is compressed natural gas, which is now being used to run automobiles and considered to be a relatively clean fuel. Natural gas and diesel are used for electricity generation too. LPG comes in cylinders or through pipes and is used as fuel for cooking. I would like to mention here that energy is also harnessed from sun, wind, animal excreta, sea and radioactive minerals. Now let me talk about metals, ores and minerals. Metal ores are chemical compounds of metal. These ores are found as deposits in earth. Earth has its storehouse, many minerals and metals. Humans have dug up mines and removed massive amount of aluminium, iron, copper, lead, zinc, mercury, etc. from their natural deposits. Why? Human-made utensils, vehicles, aeroplanes and spacecraft using aluminium. Iron and its alloys are used for making armament, railway lines, bogies and engines. Copper is used for industrial containers, electric wires and is also used in the telecom industry. We also use copper and zinc for making brass items. And of course, do not forget jewelry made of gold, silver and platinum. Natural resources such as land, water, energy, minerals have all been utilized by humans since long. Let us now talk about the biotic resources of the environment. Biotic means living, and so these resources are plants, animals and microbes. I said microbes, what are they and of what use are they to human beings? Microorganisms such as bacteria, protists and fungi, which are so minute that they can be seen only under the microscope. Some of them cause disease, but some also help to ferment food, stuff such as pizza bases, dough, bread or bhaturas, or drinks distilled in breweries. Microbes also clean the environment by degrading waste and dead animals and plants. Plants, of course, give us oxygen for breathing and food in the form of vegetables and fruits. What about our staple food, rice and dal? Rice and wheat are seed of plants. They are grains, but we cultivate and so are pulses and spices. Plants also provide fibers like cotton and jute for us to make bags and clothes. Rubber, resin, wood are all plant products used by us for making various articles used in daily life. Many plants provide medicines also. Do you think plants are more useful to us than animals? Well, that we shall have to debate, but animals also help humans in many ways. Cattle gives us milk and meat. Poultry gives meat and eggs. Fish, prawns, crabs are also eaten. Draught animals like mules, oxen, camel, horse and elephants are used to transport material from one place to another. Some beetles give medicines. Silk moth gives silk and sheep and give wool. Now, you must be aware that how we are dependent on both the biotic and abiotic natural resources. On one hand, natural resources are fast depleting because of over-exploitation by humans. On the other hand, Earth is becoming a big dumping ground for waste generated by the activities of the fast-growing human population. This is becoming a cause of concern as it is resulting in the deterioration of human, animal and plant life. So, dear learners, it is important that by overuse of natural resources, we do not upset the balance in nature. Let us care for our environment. Learners, now the time to talk about the relationship between primitive humans, human society and environment. How did the primitive human discover agriculture and when did they begin leading a settled life? Modern humans evolved about 2 million years ago from ape-like ancestors. The two major trends in human evolution have been enlarged brain and bipedal gait or movement. These two evolutionary trends gave humans many advantages over other animals. Large brain helped to think, decide, communicate, and hands became free to use for tool making and multifarious tasks. Now we come to the story of human evolution. When human evolution began, forests had dwindled because of glaciation. Much of the land surface was, however, still covered by forest. The common ancestors of ape and humans had to come down from trees where they lived. They walked on all four limbs on the ground. Recent molecular studies have revealed that from common ancestors, evolution of apes and that of humans diverged about 6 million years ago. Do you know that Homo sapiens is the scientific name of humans? It means the wise Homo. Hominidae is the family to which humans belong. I am sure you must be curious to know about our ancestry. The first ever known human was Australopithecus. They were also known as ape men. They were naked, walked upright and used tools made up of bones and pebbles. Australopithecines gave rise to Homo habilis, probably around 2.5 million years ago. These human ancestors had ape-like or long arms but larger brain size than the Australopithecus. Their brain size was intermediate between Australopithecus and modern humans. Also, they had heavy ridge above eyes like the apes. Homo erectus made stone axes, hunted for animals and discovered fire. The next stage, Homo erectus is supposed to have existed between 1.5 million years to 200,000 years ago. Their fossils have been found in China, Java and Germany. This suggests that they evolved in Africa and then spread to Asia and Europe. Next to evolve from Homo erectus were the Neanderthal men, but they belong to the same species as do the modern humans, Homo sapiens. Remains of Neanderthals have been found in Europe, Asia and Africa. They fashioned a large variety of well-made tools and were successful hunters. Soon, Neanderthal man became extinct, but another line of humans, the Homo sapiens sapiens, evolved, and they are considered to be direct ancestors of the modern humans. Having studied about our evolution, let us now see how calm, primitive hunters and gatherers, human discovered fire. Along with human evolution, skills also improved progressively in tool making. Primitive humans, the hunters and gatherers, moved from place to place as foragers. They led to nomadic life. As nomads, they roamed large and distant areas. They had no permanent abode. They lived near water bodies such as river beds and lakes, located on the edges of forest where plants and animals were abundant. They also lived in caves. They lived in groups of 20 to 30. They roamed in the forest in search of food during the day and returned to the caves at sunset to save themselves from the attack of wild animals. As they moved along, they left behind their stones and bone implements. Their main occupation in life was to procure food. Their diet consists of seeds, roots and fruits of plants and small animals, which they killed with tools they made from pebbles and stones. Now we come to the making of tools. Making tools was a major activity for primitive humans. Tools for hunting, tools for protecting from wild animals, tools for cultivation. There was a gradual improvement in the tools according to the need. Thus, older cultural Paleolithic age ushered in New Stone Age or Neolithic age. In between the two is the Mesolithic age or Middle Stone Age. Paleolithic humans or Old Stone Age humans made simple shapes. So, stone tools, example hand axes and sticks that were 100,000 years old. Mesolithic humans used flint tools to make arrowheads and spears. Rocks were used for making tools. They used quartz, quartzite and other volcanic rocks for making various types of tools. Neolithic humans used much more advanced tools. They used antler, bone, wooden hammer and hammer stone to chip off uniform flakes from the rocks to make bows and arrows, harpoons, knives, fish hooks, needles, etc. Human accidentally discovered fire while making tools. This is all about how humans evolved and how they interact with the environment. Now the time to sum up the whole content in terms of what you have learned so far. The earth bears several natural resources, of which the non-living or abiotic resources are land, water, air, fossil fuels and minerals, and the living or biotic resources are plants, animals and microorganisms. Humans, apart from food, require two major types of resources, namely materials and energy for comfort and economic development. Ever since humans appeared on earth, they have been drawing their food, clothing and other substances from nature. Humans have evolved more than 2 million years ago, when they diverged from apes with whom they shared a common ancestor. The earliest bipedal humans were the Australopithecus, who evolved in Africa. They were ape-like but had larger brains. The next stage in human evolution was Homo erectus, with larger brain and erect posture. Their fossils have been found in Java and China. Homo sapiens, Neanderthal man, arose from Homo erectus. Soon they became extinct, but another line of humans, the Homo sapiens sapiens, evolved, and they are considered to be the direct ancestry of the modern humans. Primitive humans lived in forest and were hunters and gatherers. They moved from place to place in search of food and led a nomadic life. Along with human evolution, skills also improved progressively in tool making. Humans made simple tools with stones, starting from crude pebble tools. As time passed, they made better and sharper tools. In the Neolithic or New Stone Age, the tools were polished and ground. Dear learners, this is all about the part 1 of the lesson 2, Environment and Human Society. We will come again to meet you with a new program of environmental science. Thank you. Ah, 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 ah.
जीवन ये प्रकाशित करने, राहों को आलोकित करने। हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने, हम अपना रास्ता स्वयं चुने। कभी पढ़े हम कहीं पढ़े वे विषय की लोच से युक्त हो, मित्रों हम उठे और जागे, मंजिल आने की ध्वनि सुने। हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने, हम अपना
साल का लंबा सफर और लाखों लोगों के चेहरों पर खिलती मुस्कान, गर्व और गरिमा से जीने की प्रेरणा देती मुस्कान, आत्मसम्मान और विश्वास से पैदा हुई मुस्कान, इन खिलते चेहरों पर ये मुस्कान आई है शिक्षा के जरिए। ये मुस्कान आई है नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ओपन स्कूलिंग यानी NIOS के जरिए। नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ओपन स्कूलिंग या राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालयी शिक्षा संस्थान, इस संस्थान का एक बड़ा उद्देश्य है आम आदमियों के जीवन को बेहतर बनाना। ऐसे लोग जिनके लिए शिक्षा एक दूर का सपना है, या वे बच्चे जो परिवार की रोजी रोटी कमाने के लिए बीच में ही स्कूल छोड़ने पर मजबूर हो जाते हैं। NIOS ऐसे बच्चों और बड़ों को दोबारा शिक्षा से जुड़ने का मौका मुहैया कराता है ताकि वे एक बेहतर जीवन जी सकें। 1989 में स्थापना के बाद NIOS ने देश के लाखों बच्चों और वयस्कों को बेहतर शिक्षा से जोड़ा है। इनमें हर उम्र, हर पृष्ठभूमि, हर जाति, हर मजहब और हर क्षेत्र के लड़के लड़कियां, महिलाएं और पुरुष शामिल हैं। बड़ई से लेकर पायलट, डॉक्टर, इंजीनियर, बेकर और दर्जी तक, NIOS कोशिश कर रहा है सबको शिक्षित और सशक्त बनाने की, चाहे वो असम के दूर दराज इलाके में रहने वाला हो या फिर मुंबई जैसे महानगर का। NIOS ने अपनी मौजूदगी हर जगह दर्ज कराई है। NIOS ने शिक्षा की परंपरागत सोच को ही बदल दिया है। वो पढ़िए जो हम पढ़ाते हैं की जगह NIOS की नई सोच है, हम वो पढ़ाते हैं जो आप पढ़ना चाहते हैं। इस नई सोच ने लोगों को आगे बढ़ने और NIOS के साथ जुड़ने के लिए प्रोत्साहित किया है। शिक्षा उपलब्ध कराने के मामले में NIOS किसी सीमा को नहीं मानता, उम्र की सीमा को भी नहीं। चंडीगढ़ के गणेश के लिए भी NIOS एक वरदान साबित हुआ। NIOS शारीरिक रूप से अक्षम बच्चों को भी बेहतर शिक्षा मुहैया कराने के लिए पूरी तरह प्रतिबद्ध है। ऐसे बच्चों के लिए शिक्षा न केवल रोजगार के द्वार खोलती है बल्कि उन्हें आत्मविश्वास और गर्व के साथ जीना भी सिखाती है। NIOS खेल के इन सितारों को उनकी सुविधा और समय के अनुसार बेहतर शिक्षा उपलब्ध कराता है। मेरी कॉम, सोमदेव देववर्मन, देविका रिबेका पल्लिकल, अरमान इब्राहिम, प्रद्युमन प्रकाश और अमय ज्योत सिंह, NIOS सीमा पर खड़े उन प्रहरियों को भी शिक्षा से लाभान्वित करता है जो देश की सुरक्षा के लिए अपनी जान की बाजी लगाने से भी नहीं चूकते। सच तो ये है कि NIOS की पहुंच हर ओर रहती है, चाहे वो दूर दराज के आदिवासी हो या जेल की कोठरी में बंद कैदी या फिर ग्रामीण और शहरी क्षेत्रों के गरीब निवासी। देश में कहीं भी कोई भी व्यक्ति, स्त्री, पुरुष, लड़का, लड़की, अमीर, गरीब, शिक्षा से वंचित न रहे। राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालय शिक्षा संस्थान का यही मिशन है।
राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालय शिक्षा संस्थान पूरे देश में शिक्षा के साथ साथ कौशल विकास के क्षेत्र में बहुत सारे कोर्सेज दे रहा है। लगभग 100 से ज़्यादा कोर्सेज हैं। हम दूर दराज के गांव में अपने संस्थान बनाते हैं और वहां के बच्चों को, वहां के बच्चियों को, वहां के वयस्कों को हुनर के क्षेत्र में शिक्षा पहुंचाते हैं। आपको जानकर खुशी होगी कि अब हम आर्ट, साइंस, कॉमर्स जिन क्षेत्रों में 12वीं का सर्टिफिकेट दिया जाता रहा है, अब हम हुनर के क्षेत्र में, वोकेशनल एरिया में भी 10वीं और 12वीं का सर्टिफिकेशन करेंगे। तो वो बच्चे जो कृषि से जुड़े हुए हैं, कारपेंट्री से जुड़े हुए हैं या दूसरे क्षेत्रों से जुड़े हुए हैं, वो अपने ही क्षेत्र में काम करेंगे, सीखेंगे, हुनर पैदा करेंगे अपने में और सर्टिफाइड भी होंगे कि वो सर्टिफाइड कृषक हैं, खेतिहर हैं। तो आज तक जो हमारे देश में ये सोच रही है कि आप 12वीं पास तभी कहे जाएंगे जब भूगोल, अर्थशास्त्र, भौतिकी ये पढ़ेंगे, अब ये समय बदल गया है। ITI में जितने बच्चे पढ़ते हैं, लगभग 18 लाख बच्चे हर साल दाखिला लेते हैं, अब हम उनको सर्टिफिकेशन करेंगे।
NIOS अपने छात्रों को माध्यमिक स्तर पर 26 और उच्च माध्यमिक स्तर पर 19 विषयों का विकल्प देता है। पढ़ाई किस माध्यम से करनी है, इसमें भी आपको लचीलापन मिलेगा। माध्यमिक स्तर पर ही 7 भाषाओं के अलग अलग माध्यमों का विकल्प मौजूद है। शैक्षणिक कार्यक्रमों के अलावा 86 वोकेशनल शिक्षा कार्यक्रम भी उपलब्ध हैं, जो छात्रों को कामकाजी दुनिया के लिए तैयार करते हैं। वोकेशनल प्रशिक्षण को अधिक सुदृढ़ बनाने के लिए NIOS ने ITDC, सिस्को, इंडियन मेडिकल एसोसिएशन जैसे कई सरकारी और गैर सरकारी संस्थानों के साथ भागीदारी स्थापित की है। आज लाखों छात्रों के लिए अपनी पसंद का स्कूल है राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालयी शिक्षा संस्थान यानी नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ओपन स्कूलिंग। NIOS ने एक लंबा सफर तय किया है, लेकिन मंजिल अभी दूर है। निरंतर विकास और नवीनीकरण के लिए NIOS सदैव प्रतिबद्ध है। शिक्षा का उद्देश्य महज रोजगार जुटाना ही नहीं है, बल्कि स्वयं को सशक्त बनाना भी है। NIOS लाखों छात्रों के लिए यही आत्मसम्मान दिलाने में जुटा है। लाखों लोगों के लिए एक आशा और उम्मीद है। नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ओपन स्कूलिंग। शिक्षा सबके लिए, कहीं भी, कभी भी।
हिंदुस्तान के हर कोने में नौजवानों के पास प्रतिभा है, उन्हें अवसर चाहिए।
NIOS देता रहा है युवाओं को अवसर आगे बढ़ने का। NIOS से पढ़ने वाले इन युवाओं ने किया है संस्थान को गौरवान्वित। दिव्यांगों ने बन के दिखाया है सबल और आत्मनिर्भर। NIOS के साथ आप भी जुड़िए। NIOS के संग।